Hello, we are back. Now the next chapter, 2.16, total internal reflection. So in the last chapter we discussed the index of refraction. Speed of light gets reduced when light is traveling inside a medium, like air, water, glass, and many, many more, basically every medium. We derived had a look at the Snell's law. N2 sinus theta 2 is equal to N1 sinus theta 1, where N2 and N1 are the indices of refraction of the two media. And that's shown here in the view graph below, N1 and N2. We get an incoming light beam with an angle theta 1, which is reflected at exactly the same angle, theta 1 prime. And let me please make a correction here. In the last chapter, I made a mistake here. My apology for that. Theta 1 is not the angle here outside. It's the angle from the normal to the incoming beam. So please correct that in your own lecture notes. Theta 2 was correct in my last lecture video. Theta 2 is the refracted light beam. Here, I did choose an example where N1 is larger than N2, so we are coming from an optical dense medium like glass to an optical lighter medium like air. In that case, the refracted angle theta 2 is larger than theta 1. And now let's consider the following case. What is if I increase theta 1 more and more? I make it flatter and flatter here. That means this angle here will also increase. And at some point, the refracted beam will be perpendicular to the surface. And that is a special event, and that's called the total internal reflection. So there's a critical angle where theta 2 reaches 90 degrees, and beyond that point, the entire intensity of the incoming light is perfectly reflected, total reflection. So let me write that down. There's a critical angle of the incident light. Where the refracted angle becomes 90 degrees. Beyond that angle, at that angle and beyond, the total intensity of light is reflected. The entire light is reflected. And that's so-called angle, critical angle of total internal reflection. So we can calculate that now. N2 sinus theta 2 is N1 times sinus theta 1. And we want the following condition. Theta 2 is 90 degrees. If you plug that in, sinus of 90 degrees is 1, so we get N2 is N1 times sinus theta 1.
or sinus theta 1 is N2 divided by N1. Remember, N1 was larger than N2.
So, and this is now called
the critical angle for total internal reflection. Is that an important property for us, for technical applications? The answer is yes. That's basically the working principle of optical fibers. That's the trick behind an optical fiber, and I think you all know about the efforts to speed up internet with optical fibers. So, if we have an optical fiber, we can actually even bend it . The light will always be totally reflected inside that fiber. Is my cartoon here realistic or not? Would we still get total internal reflection for such a loop? Let's have a look. Let's calculate that. So, example glass to air. So, N1 is glass. Index of refraction 4.6, and air is roughly 1. You heard before it's 1.0026 or something like that, so it's almost 1. Let's keep it simple here. If you now plug it in, sinus theta, the critical angle, 1 divided by 1.46. If you do that calculation, you realize that the critical angle is actually rather large. It's 43.2 degrees. So the critical angle in an optical fiber is indeed rather large. So a cartoon like that, a loop like that, would still provide you with a perfect total internal reflection. So the entire intensity of the light is actually stored inside the optical fiber. It's reflected internally. That's one of the applications here. Next chapter is actually about another interesting critical angle, the so-called Brewster angle. And using reflection on a surface, you can actually polarize light. Chapter 2.17, polarization and reflection. That's a trick widely used also in photography. And my cameraman is watching now carefully. So, what is if we shine polarized light on a medium with another index of reflection? So let me now use the first condition, out of plane polarization. Snell's law again. And let me choose now N1 smaller, N2, N1 here, N2.
So simple the example, we are looking at a window, air to glass.
And again, the critical angles theta 1, theta 1 prime, and theta 2 are here, starting from the normal to the surface.
So out of plane means I'm looking into that plane.
So the electric field is vibrating here out of the plane of the board. Field waves are approaching the surface. What happens here now at the surface? The light is coming from that direction. It's vibrating in this direction.
So the dipoles, the electric charges here at the surface, can start to oscillate. They get excited by the incoming light. They start to oscillate here in that plane. And next moment they emit light, the reflected light and the transmitted light.
There is no loss. That works perfectly. There's no perturbation in the reflected and refracted light.
And let me now make the other example. In that case, the electric field vector of our light is in plane. In the plane of our board, which means the electric field oscillates like that, in the plane of the board. The incoming light hits the surface, and now the dipoles get actually excited in that direction, perpendicular to the beam of light. They act like Hertz dipoles, both antenna and receiver. After they start to oscillate, they start to emit light. That's the refracted light. There's no problem with that. This is perfectly passing through. However, if you remember my cartoon about the Hertz dipole, the radiation characteristics, that's x direction, the intensity characteristics looked like that. There is no radiation emitted in the perpendicular direction. Nothing is emitted in this direction. This does not happen. If you now look at the view graph here again, there is no forward radiation in this direction. This is canceled out. So if this angle from here to here reads 90 degrees, perfectly perpendicular here, then we do not get a reflected wave.
For the case that the E field is in the plane of our geometry of that setup, or simply spoken in the plane of our board here, there is no reflection for the case that the two angles theta 1 plus theta 2 are exactly 90 degrees. That's exactly the condition when the Hertz dipoles are pointing in the direction of the reflected beam, because in the direction of the oscillation of charge carriers, electrons, in that up direction, there is no electric field emitted. That's perfectly canceled out. So let me use a sketch here. Here the reflection of light, and I'll come to that definition in a minute. And here actually the angle from 0 to 90 degrees, that's our total angle theta 1. It starts off at 1/2 for the perpendicular, for the parallel component, the in-plane component. We indeed get a certain angle where the entire intensity of the reflected light disappears. However, for the perpendicular component, we just get a smooth increase. So that's that condition here. The electric field is vibrating out of plane. The Hertz dipoles at the surface, all of them get perfectly excited, and we get a scattered light in reflection and in refraction direction. For the case that the electric field is in the plane of our board, case is shown here, there's a certain angle where the forward direction of that Hertz dipole vibration is exactly in the direction of the reflected light, and in that condition, there is no reflection at all. So that would be the typical curve of the reflection. So actually, I can write that down. The reflection index is actually the reflected intensity. Intensity means squared, divided by the incoming intensity squared. And if you now plug the refraction indices in, you will get the following rule here. That's minus sinus theta 1 minus theta 2 divided by sinus theta 1 plus sinus theta 2. And for the parallel component, it would be E parallel for the reflected and E parallel for the incoming intensity. And that gives tangent theta 1 minus theta 2 divided by tangent theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay, so if you look at that picture here, if you use that trick of the Brewster angle, you can actually polarize light partly or completely by using the trick of the Brewster angle. One component, the one parallel to the plane, gets perfectly polarized at that angle, the reflected light component here completely disappears, and the only remaining part is the other polarization, the one out of plane. That trick is used in photography. You can get linear polarizers, polarization filters for your photo objective, and in one setting, you could actually just see the reflection of the window, the bright sky, and if you now rotate that linear polarizer by 90 degrees, you can look right through into the room and you won't see the sky anymore. So that's a widely used trick in photography if you get your hands on a linear polarizer. So the very last step here is, actually a quick side note, these two equations are just for your own information. This goes beyond the exam. But what I wanted to show you is I wanted to calculate the Brewster angle now for you. So we use again Snell's law, N2 sinus theta 2 is equal to N1 sinus theta 1. And we use the condition for the Brewster angle, namely that the theta 1 plus theta 2 must be 90 degrees. So let's plug that in. N2 sinus theta of the Brewster angle is N1 sinus theta 1. Now we can replace theta 1 with that expression. N2 sinus Brewster angle is N1 sinus, and now 90 degrees minus the Brewster angle. That expression can be replaced by cosine. N2 sinus theta Brewster is N1 cosine theta of the Brewster angle. And simply spoken, the tangent of the Brewster angle is sinus divided by cosine. That's N1 divided by N2. So if you know the index of refraction of glass, of your glass window, and the index of refraction of air, you can calculate the Brewster angle. The name Brewster angle is coming actually from a British scientist, Sir David Brewster, roughly the year 1812. That's where I would like to complete that chapter about Snell's law, reflection and refraction. Thank you very much for your attention.